I am going to talk about the Mac Mini and how my experience as a, well, I will say like not primarily, but a Windows and Linux user for using Linux for 26 plus years and probably Windows for 30 plus years. So how is that my experience with that background with macOS? I will say this, I did use macOS from 2008 to about 2010. So why, one of the biggest reasons why I wanted a Mac Mini was that, in my humble opinion, and I know a lot of people disagree with this, but it's kind of the best of the Linux world and the best of the Windows world. So you get all of the support for companies like Logitech, Elgato, Adobe, Autodesk, you know, I could go on and on and on and on and on. But you also get the nerdiness. You know, you get like a Unix-like system. You could go into the terminal and you can post in commands to your fucking nuts falls off. And you can install Homebrew and get 90 or 99% of all of the software we run already on the Linux. So I can do both. You can also get a lot of open source software on the Windows. But I think Homebrew takes us to a little bit of an extra step on the macOS. One of my gripes with Linux was that, well, so if I buy peripherals, there's almost no native app support for most peripherals on the Linux. So you have to use somewhat that's reverse engineered from someone in the spare time. That kind of works. Well, when I buy a headset, expensive mouse and keyboard, I also buy it for the features, not just for a keyboard. Because if I just want a keyboard, I don't buy an expensive keyboard. I just buy a cheaper keyboard or cheaper headset, decent sound quality. But a lot of people like me, we buy peripherals because of the quality, and they do what they do. You know, a keyboard is a keyboard, but it also gives us a lot of extra features. And nowadays, those extra features are tied in with software. And I know we don't need it, but it's nice to have, and I paid for the fucking thing. So when I pay for it, I want to use it. Let's get the entry level, like the cheapest system you can get, because if I don't like it in a month or 2 months, have I wasted a lot of money? Yeah. But I have not wasted so much money as I would if I bought the highest end Mac Mini or the mid-tier Mac Mini. So it was like, yeah, you get the cheaper one, and if you really, really like it, you can save up for like a 16 gig, 32 gig of RAM system like next year or something like that, and sell the other one on eBay or whatever. December's videos have all been made on macOS or edited on macOS. I have no problem with 8 gigs of RAM on my system. No warnings, nothing like that. However, I am a little bit more restrictive with how many tabs and stuff like that I open. So I have a 32 gig Windows machine that I'm recording this video on right now because I haven't moved the OBS over to Mac yet. I don't care about how many fucking tabs and windows I have open and stuff like that. On the Mac OS, I don't know if I should, but because I know I only have 8 gig, it's still back in my mind. You know, let's not go too crazy with opening up too many naughty sites and stuff like that. So I haven't had any issues because I've limited myself. But those 8 gig limitations was kind of are still in my head. But I haven't had any problem yet. And I played World of Warcraft and stuff like that, which we're going to right now. Gaming is kind of okay. I can play, if you find a native supported game, World of Warcraft, arcade games, and there's actually plenty of Steam games that work natively on macOS. And if you play them, for the most part, not have an issue. I had one issue with, what was it? That in the water thing. Not Below Zero, but the other one. Subnautica. It was a shadowing thing. I don't know why it was acting up. Everything worked perfectly, but the shadows was a little bit flickering in and out. And it's probably just something I need to take off somewhere. But I played on 1440p, medium to high. And again, this is just basic entry-level Mac Mini. The games that I like to play, they are great. And if I want to play like Cyberpunk and stuff like that, I just, you know, switch my input on my monitor, and my Windows machine is already running. I just changed my mouse because my keyboard is Bluetooth, so I can switch between devices, and I can play Cyber. One thing that really impressed me, and it sounds stupid and weird, it's how quiet it is. And you don't know that you want that until you have experienced it. I built my Ryzen system the beginning this year. It's a Ryzen 7600X, and I used not cheap, but not massively expensive air cooler. The specs should be handling it, and the test said that it was a decent air cooler and what have you not. I bought it, I installed it, and every time I did anything more than, you know, browsing the web, you could start to hear the fans. If I went into games and they were not massive, but just somewhat CPU intensive, or if I was video editing, they were really going mental, like massively mental. And then I was like, you know what, these are going massively mental, so let me buy a AIO So I bought like a mid-tier AIO with actually really good fans on it. And yeah, that was way quieter than my mid-tier air cooler. But it still makes sounds when I was playing games, when I was singing, when I was editing. Once in a while, when it was casting and stuff like that, it would be like... And way louder than that, by the way. Not as much as my air cooler, but still a lot of noise. And with the nature of the way that they are building CPUs nowadays, because we are kind of on the limit of what we can do with the silicon architecture and design of the CPU, so to get you more power because you want more power, they're just jamming more fucking wattage into it and stuff like that. Watt and wattage, which means that they are running harder and harder and harder. And if you don't believe me, I went from an average boost speed without overclocking anything for about 4.9 to 5 gigahertz on an air cooler that should be handling my CPU with no issues whatsoever to an average of 5.3 to 5.4 boost speed with an AIO. So if that don't tell you that you need an AIO on a Ryzen system, I don't know how I can do at least a Ryzen 7 series, 7000 series, because I got 300 megahertz for free just by putting a better cooler on. And that tells me, and should tell you, that there is a massive heat issue. So the quietness of the Mac Mini, like when I was editing and rendering, I don't hear anything. Another thing that I really like about it is the simplicity. It's just simple. Mac OS, and this is one of the things I always loved about Mac OS, and I wish Windows and Linux would do more of, it's doing what it needs to do without the user having to click shit ton of buttons or getting shit ton of prompts. I like that simplicity, that unless I absolutely need to interact with it, it don't tell me to do something. I can even fucking disable the confirmation of deleting, you know, items and moving them into the trash can or recycle bin, and also just deleting them there from the trash can recycle bin. I can also disable confirmation for that, so just do it. If it's a security matter, so if you install a program, it needs, you know, you need to plug in your password. Makes sense. I just like the sensibility of macOS, where if it makes sense to have the user do something, we will let the user do something. But if it don't make sense, why the fuck should we pester the user while they're doing work? And Linux, in my opinion, Linux is notoriously bad at this. Windows is just as bad as overcomplicating simple things. Another thing, and this is probably something that will angry a lot of people, I'm starting to think that macOS is probably more secure out of the box than Windows and Linux. When I install a program on Linux, yes, I have to put in my sudo password, but it just automatically hijacks my keyboard, my mouse, it hijacks my microphone, it hijacks my sound systems, it hijacks access to my folders. The same with Windows. Sometimes with Windows, I don't even have to put in a password. But when I open a program, it just hijacks everything without telling me. When I installed Discord on macOS, I had to put in a password. Then I opened it up and it was like, you do know that Discord is registering your keystrokes, even not if you're not using the program. And it wants to give you want access to these folders and these peripherals and stuff like that. And I had to agree to it. I had to say, yes, you can access my webcam. Yes, you can basically key lock my keys. And it did that with OBS. It did it with almost any software that listened to anything. It was like, hey, you do know this software wants to do these things that could mean that it could, you know, potentially infringe on your privacy. And I like that. I wish Linux did that. I wish Windows did that. Let's go into the bad things, because there are some things that, like, from day one, it would take the living shit out of me. Dongles. Yeah, you need to live in dongle hell. That's how it is. I had one dongle that I was using on my Windows machine, and I had to buy another dongle with HDMI output to get my second screen to work. However, I will say this. A lot of people misunderstand USB connections, and I will make a video about that. But you can plug as many dongles into one port as you want, as long as you're not exceeding the bandwidth limitation of that port. And that's determined by the chipset. When you look behind your computer and you see 10,000 USB devices or connections, they may only be controlled by one or two USB controllers. So that means that, let's say they are all 5 gigabytes per second. Let's say you have 10 ports. That means that 5 of those are running off a 5 gigabytes per second controller. So if you plug something in one of those ports that take off 5 gigabytes per second, you cannot use the other ports. You're all saturating the bandwidth. So that's the only thing you have to keep in mind. But people don't do that with computers because it's really hard to oversaturate, you know, USB 3.0 and up bandwidth with the peripherals we have nowadays. A mouse like this takes about 12 megabytes per second. This is a gaming mouse with a high pull rate. So you need to do a lot to sort of saturate the bandwidth. And if you're using the Thunderbolt 4 USB 4 connection on the Mac Mini, we are talking 40 gigabytes per second. So you can put as many dongles as you want into that bot and that connection, and put as many peripherals into that dongle, as long as the combined bandwidth don't succeed 40 gigabytes per second. The other bad thing is the price. Like, you won't get a better computer for $600 or $500 or $550 or whatever you can find it for as the entry-level Mac Mini. You know, if you're not doing video editing 10 hours a day with 10,000 After Effects layers and stuff like that. Most people can live with an entry-level Mac Mini. But if you're a gamer, if you are a massive video editor, 3D artist, and blah, 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 and you go over the entry-level Mac Mini, it starts to get expensive. They overprice you for storage, they overprice you for RAM. It's stupid. Ridiculously overpricing their RAM and stuff like that. Think about this. Maybe I should do like a 3 month later video, 6 months later video. Let me hear down below. I will do that. See you all later. Bye-bye.